Good morning and Lord's blessings as we welcome you into Good Shepherd Lutheran Church today. Pray the Lord's blessings be upon you as we worship together. If you are a guest or visitor to Good Shepherd, we welcome you in Christ's name. It's nice to have you join your voice with ours as we worship together. Our order of service for this morning is going to be the Divine Service setting number one. That'll be on page 151 in the front portion of your hymnal. Our opening hymn is 658, entitled Preserve Your Word, O Savior, and we will be standing on the last verse.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As the called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our intro for this day is in your worship folder from Psalm chapter 90. The congregational tune is LSV 577. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. Return, O Lord, how long will you tarry? Be gracious to your servant. Satisfy us each morning with your steadfast love, so that we may rejoice and be glad all the days of our life. Make us glad as many days as you have afflicted us, and as many years as we have suffered adversity. Let your work be manifest to your servants, and your glorious power to their children. Of the Lord our God be upon us. Prosper for us the work of our hands. Oh, prosper the work of our hands. Word continues in the front portion of your hymnal on pages 152 and 153 with the Kyrie. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. The peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Thank you. Help us to forsake all trust in earthly gain and to find in you our heavenly treasure. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Scripture lesson for today, the 20th Sunday after Pentecost, comes from the 5th chapter of Amos, verses 6 and 7 and 10 through 15. Seek the Lord and live, lest he break out like a fire in the house of Joseph, and it devour with none to quench it for Bethel. O you who turn justice to wormwood and cast down righteousness to the earth. They hate him who reproves in the gate, and they abhor him who speaks the truth. Therefore, because you trample on the poor, and you exact taxes of grain from him, you have built houses of hewn stone, but you shall not dwell in them. You have planted pleasant vineyards, but you shall not drink their wine. For I know how many are your transgressions, and how great are your sins, you who afflict the righteous, you who take a bribe, and turn aside the needy in the gate. Therefore, he who is prudent will keep silent in such a time, for it is an evil time. Seek good and not evil, that you may live. And so the Lord, the God of hosts, will be with you. As you have said, hate evil and love good, and establish justice in the gate, that it may be the Lord, the God of hosts, will be gracious to the remnant of Joseph. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading for this morning is in the book of Hebrews, the 3rd chapter, verses 12 to 19. We're going to read those verses together as printed on the back of your worship folder. Following the reading, we will rise and sing the Alleluia in verse on page 156. Let us then read together. Take care, brothers, lest there be in any of you an evil, unbelieving heart, leading you to fall away from the living God. But exhort one another every day, as long as it is called today, that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. For we share in Christ, if indeed we hold our original confidence firm to the end. As it is said, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts, as in the rebellion. For who were those who heard and yet rebelled? Was it not all those who left Egypt led by Moses? And with whom was he provoked for 40 years? Was it not with those who sinned, whose bodies fell in the wilderness? And to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, but to those who were disobedient? So we see that they were unable to enter because of unbelief. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise. According to St. Mark, the 10th chapter. As Jesus was setting out on his journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments, do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not bear false witness, do not defraud, honor your father and mother." And he said to him, "Teacher, all these I have kept from my youth." And Jesus said, looking at him, loved him, and said to him, "You lack one thing. Go, sell all that you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come, follow me. Disheartened by the saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. This is the gospel of the Lord. Thank you. Jesus died so we might live. Amen. Text will serve as base for our message is our Old Testament reading from Amos chapter 5, verses 6 to 7 and 10 to 15, dear friends in Christ. For many of us who have learned history, it is taught that the tragic incident of March 5, 1770 is called the Boston Massacre. For most colonials of that day, that name was all they needed or cared to know. It was true, everyone agreed, that on that night, 8 British soldiers, under the command of Captain Thomas Preston, had fired into a crowd of citizens, killing 5. And as far as local opinion was concerned, the soldiers had massacred innocent civilians and deserved to be punished as murderers. The cry went up for justice, but justice certainly wasn't to mean a fair hearing for the soldiers. One lawyer after another declined to defend them. Finally, Preston begged of all people, John Adams, to take their case. Adams was already well known as a proponent of the colonial cause against the British, and he was considering running for office. He knew that defending the hated redcoats might cost him his political aspirations, but his conscience wouldn't let him keep silent. Adams did take the case, and all the defendants were either acquitted or given life sentences when Adams proved they were provoked. Facts, Adams said, are stubborn things. And whatever may be our wishes, our inclinations, or the dictates of our passion, they cannot alter the state of facts and evidence. John Adams had the courage to speak the facts. What about us? We live in a time when the Christian memory is fading fast. The biblical narrative has lost its luster in the world after 2 centuries of attack by modernist anti-spiritual worldviews. Our text from the book of Amos has a warning for living in such times. Grasping this thought can have eternal consequences. You have the right to remain silent. That's one of our rights here in the land of the free and the home of the brave. It came out of a court decision from 1966, Miranda versus Arizona. Ever since then, law enforcement must give a person their Miranda rights. And the beginning of those rights goes like this. You have the right to remain silent. Anything you say or do may be used against you in a court of law. Now, most of us would probably agree with this statement that I've been sharing with others. I've heard too much. You see, silence is normally not a problem in our society, but silence can be, in certain situations, deadly. So let's find out what was happening at the time that Amos wrote his text. You see, in 8th century B.C., it was a time of great danger for Israel and Judah because they had forsaken the Lord their God. Corruption and idolatry were rampant in the land. And as a result, the northern kingdom of Israel, here called Joseph in our text, was called to repentance. Prophets were sent by God to speak to the people. But the message was not heard or believed. Ultimately, both the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom would fall. But Amos could not keep silent. He had to speak, and speak he does. They hate him who reproves in the gate, and they abhor him who speaks the truth. If you expose those who oppress, if you call out those who blaspheme, if you speak the truth in love, you can expect some blowback. The facts of God's word are stubborn things. But modern-day charlatans do not change them. My conscience will not allow me to sit idly by. Silence in certain situations can mean approval or indifference. You have the right to remain silent, but should you? Amos helps us answer that question in verse 13. Therefore, he who is prudent will keep silent in such a time, for it is an evil time. Every age is going to produce a multitude of people who see evil. They know it's wrong, but they fear man more than God. Our silence in the face of evil may seem prudent from the perspective of personal safety and benefit, but by it we can stand condemned by the law of God. Now's not the time for silence, but for repentance. We have two options in the face of evil: either the prudence of silence, or else speaking up for God's word for those who have no voice. Which results in the blessing of God? Our Lord answers that also in our text, our last two verses. Seek good and not evil, that you may live. And so the Lord God of hosts will be with you, as you have said. Hate evil and love good, and establish justice in the gate. It may be that the Lord, the God of hosts, will be gracious to the remnant of Joseph. And how is this all done? Through the prevailing opposite of our culture of injustice and oppression. Hate evil, love good, establish justice in the gate. It is living out what we have been made to be by God Himself. We plead for justice and receive none from this fallen world. Nor do we deserve justice. Yet God provides exactly that by pouring out all His wrath upon Israel, not upon Israel or upon us, but upon His own Son at Calvary. And in Him, the Lord, the God of hosts, is with us. And we with Him. As the Son dies on the cross, we die. As He rises on Easter, we rise. Here's mercy for those who know no other mercy. Mercy that washes our sin away in the water with the Word, and then continues to sustain us in His forgiveness and love and grace in the Blessed Sacrament. Jesus didn't keep silent as He challenged the self-righteous of His day and the den of thieves that were in the temple. He brought justice to the oppressed and hope to those who suffered. Jesus was no silent observer of an evil time. He came to speak the truth, and the truth was Himself. He came to redeem us who trade the truth for our own safety. Jesus, truth in the flesh, was hated for the truth He brought, and that's why He was beaten and wounded and nailed to the wood of the cross. And He came to die and enter a tomb. But truth cannot be held back by anything, even death. The message of the resurrection continues to break the silence of every evil of time. The silence is broken as we hear, because He lives, we too shall live. Silence can be deadly. Our Savior breaks the silence. You have the right to remain silent. But should you? Amen. Will you please rise at this time? We continue our worship with our confession of faith. This morning, that is the Nicene Creed, printed for you on page 158. We confess, I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of His Father before all worlds, God of God,
light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended to heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy and Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray. We pray for the church and the world, that the Holy Spirit may clothe her in Christ's charity, that she may live out the great grace of the gospel and her compassion for the lowly. We pray for President Harrison, our synodical president, for President Miller, our district president, and our circuit visitor, Pastor Berglund, and for all pastors, that they may faithfully reprove and speak the truth, that we may be kept on Christ's gracious, narrow way. For forgiveness for those places where we have feared, loved, and trusted in our possessions rather than our Lord, chasing after riches rather than following our Master on his path to eternal life. For the poor, that they may be comforted in the truth that the Lord's eyes are upon them, and that we as his children might open our hands with his to satisfy the desires of every living thing. For the gifts of God's love, who are rejected and destroyed in their mother's wombs, rather than embraced and cherished, that even as their cries ring in the ears of the Almighty, our nation may cease its willful deafness and put an end to this evil in our land. For our courts, that our judges and lawyers may serve with integrity, pursuing the cause of true justice, that the weak and innocent may be defended, and that those who do evil might mercifully be corrected and turned from their evil ways. We pray for Katie Claybooker and family at the death of her father. We ask for your grace and mercy and love be upon them as you comfort them with the knowledge that because Jesus is the resurrection and the life, those in Christ will live and we will see our loved ones again. And we give a prayer of thanks and blessing this morning for Ron and Jackie Quasney's 50th wedding anniversary. We thank you, Lord, in your time and wisdom for bringing them together, for keeping them in their love throughout all these years, for keeping them in the true faith, as faith has been a big part of their life together. And we ask, Lord, that if it be your will, you would give them many more years together in your grace and mercy and love. We pray this all in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Our worship continues now with our preface on page 160. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. The Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary. We should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who having created all things, took on human flesh and was born of the Virgin Mary. For our sake he died on the cross and rose from the dead to put an end to death, thus fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, We laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. By the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. And graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, Take ye, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always. foretaste of the feast to come and the holy supper of your Son's body and blood. Keep us firm in the true faith throughout our days of pilgrimage, that on the day of his coming we may together with all your saints celebrate the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom which has no end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace. Welcome once again in Christ's name. This week I am going to be at a pastor's conference Monday through Wednesday afternoon, so I will be out of the office, but the conference is here in town, so if you do need me, I will have my cell phone. If it's an emergency, you can contact me, or the ladies will be in the office as well if you need anything. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. I'd like to welcome the guests and visitors that I've seen here this morning. Please sign the guest register on the back if you've not done so already. Okay, I have a couple of announcements. Next Sunday is our potluck for pastor appreciation. There is a sign up on the table for things for you to bring. We do have a door offering for our seminary student at Fort Wayne, so please be generous. We are still collecting for Fort Wayne. Paul and I will be going probably late January, early February, so please bring anything for the co-op for the students there. Also, we have a sign-up for Home Sweet Home Mission. We'll be serving on November 14th, And next week there will be a collection box for donations as well. Paula, you had something.
As many of you may know or don't know, a group from ISU that deals with autistic children is going to be using our old daycare / youth area. Yesterday, we had a cleanup day, and it's amazing how clean these people got the rooms down there. But we do have some items down there that have been there for a long time that we do need to get rid of. There are two couches. If anybody needs a couch, college kids, whatever, there are two couches to be given away, a nice desk, beat-up desk, but usable, and some exercise equipment that we don't know whose it is, but it's going to go to the trash because we don't know what that, like the exercise equipment, not everything's there. We don't know what's going on with that. So if it's yours, please pick it up. If not, we will get rid of it. And if you need, if you'd like the couches, please take them. We will get rid of them by next weekend. The group is supposed to be coming in the very beginning of November. So they would like to transition into the space. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other announcements? Hearing none. Oh, Chris. Oh, yes, movie night on Friday, and it's Saving Mr. Banks. I remembered that first service. I didn't remember it this service, but come out for movie night. Anything else? Hearing nothing, go with God this week. Thank you.